Thanks. So, as you've heard, my name is Sebastian Graf. I'm working with Santaro, and as you can see from the slides, Santaro calls itself a service integration company. So, just to give you some kind of introduction, what is the difference that we see there in regards to like classical system integrator? So, usually we start with our customers to not discuss about certain boxes that they would like to get, but we start about with them what kind of services they would like to use. And we consider these boxes that we still sell as Lego bricks that we combine to a solution in order to bring a service to our customers so that they can sell it to their customers afterwards. So if you take a look at our customer base and see, okay, what is the industry, we are clearly a company servicing service providers. So I guess most of the companies here in this room would probably fit into our customer base in there. And if you take a look about how these companies actually work and how they consider their network, there's always one thing in common, and that is that these kind of companies do not run a network because they have to support their business or somehow support their business, because our customers run the network because they earn money with it. It is their business, their primary business. And this is what makes them unique comparing with a classical enterprise service provider. So myself, I've been with Santaro for around 7 years now. And in the former life, I've worked with BT Global Services, roughly about the same time in Germany. And part of my role is in the pre-sales activity, and what we usually try to do there is not position solutions at customers, so service providers, data center operators, based on data sheets of vendors, but we actually want to prove that what we think is working is actually working. And during this, what we usually consider as a proof of concept, we run our own lab facilities in Frankfurt for this, and we use this to prove it, what we are trying to achieve there. And usually what happens in there is it's still a very manual process that you define a test case with customers and you define what the goals are. Usually this is then written around in some kind of Word document that gets a few hundred pages long. And then you start over and just start ticking the boxes and say, okay, test number one, test feature X, Y, Z, test number two, test the next feature, and so on and so on. And this process repeats and repeats, and at a certain point, you're finished at some point. However, this is not where the story stops, because at some point in time, when all of this has been handed over to the customers are using this kind of services or this kind of solution, at some point in time, they usually come back to us and say, hey, I need to upgrade my system software on one of these Lego bricks that you installed. So typically, Lego bricks that run a network operating system like Junos, iOS XR, or you name it. And usually what happens is then quite similar to the original proof of concept, because you want to test that what you have originally tested and verified under a certain software version is still working with the new software version. And while this sounds like a very simple task, it's actually much more complex than you would think. And probably most of the people here in the room have experience made into the past where they said, I just want to upgrade to a new software release on a network operating system, maybe because of features that you want to use that are not part in the old software, maybe because of security issues that were in the old software, or maybe even because the software is no longer supported by your vendor and you have to upgrade. So I'm actually a believer of RFC 1925, and also here, as I mentioned, it's more complex than you think, because if you speak with people like about this problem, qualifying a new software release, for some customers, they have a turnover time for this that they estimate in months. So they say, yeah, if I want to qualify a new software release on some kind of, let's say, MPLSP router, then they usually say, yeah, it's maybe a point of 2 or 3 months to actually qualify a new software release, or maybe of a few weeks. And this usually then leads customer to act in one of three possible ways. The first way is they just don't upgrade the software because it's so intensively work and there's so much work to put in, and they tend to prefer to stick with their old software versions where they know all the bugs somehow. But at some point in time, also these customers have to upgrade the software. The next possibility is they just go the hard way and just make the software qualification, maybe with help from us, maybe on their own. And then during the software process, if you test new software, you probably have all seen this once in a while. You will find some bugs. You get back to the vendor of the software. The vendor provides you a fix for the software, and then you continue testing. But if you think about this, if you make it precise, you would have to start with the testing over and over again. Because even if the vendor tells you, hey, we have just fixed this one thing that you reported, there's always the possibility that this fix is causing another issue on the stuff that you have tested already. So you would have to test over and over again, and until you come to a certain point where you have a software which is reasonably bug-free. The other thing, or the other mode that customers tend to operate is what I like to call the plan, build, here be dragons mode. So they actually plan for a software release, they have some kind of lab setup in place, and they try if the new configuration is being loaded and accepted by the new software release, they test it a bit around, and then they hope for the best and see if any fire is breaking out once they actually deploy it. Interestingly, though, so if we talk with our customers, usually everybody say, I'm not using any special features, I'm not expecting any kind of problems. However, if you take a look about the functionality that these kind of network operating systems have these days, and the vast majority of combinations that you can use to actually combine these features, you quickly get to the point that every network is somehow unique. And it's somehow not that easy to say, hey, this is a good software release for everybody. Yeah, so the vendors try to say, hey, this is a reasonably good software and for most customers, but this is not really of any value for a specific network, and see if there's a bug inside that's actually harming your network. So we had some customer engagements in the recent past where we went with the customers together through this process, like qualifying software releases, finding out the bugs, getting back to the vendors, retesting the new software version. And this was a very lengthy process. And we somehow thought, okay, it's 2018, so there has to be a better way to actually achieve this operating of testing. So we sat back and take a look about what is there from a tools perspective to actually automate this and to actually improve this. And we quickly ended up with the robot framework. So the robot framework is originally being developed by Nokia. These days it's operated or sponsored by the Robot Framework Foundation and hosted on GitHub. So it's completely written in Python. And the nice thing about this is that it is a very generic testing framework. So it's not a framework that has been written for network operating system test. It is a framework that has been generically written to do testing. And the cool thing is it has a lot of libraries included that you can use to test stuff, but it's also possible to extend it with your own Python or Java code to actually extend it with functions that were not originally intended. And this is actually quite helpful because you can actually use it for any kind of automated testing as long as you can somehow press this kind of testing that you need into Python code. Now, you would probably ask, okay, if I have to put it in Python code, why not program it in Python directly without using the framework? Actually, the nice thing about the robot framework is that it allows you to create some kind of abstraction between the people that are actually writing the test cases themselves and the people who are actually coding the libraries in the back end. So we'll come to this later on. For the first moment, I will just show you an example about how test cases can look like. This is actually an example from the official robot documentation. So what you can see in here with the red rectangle, user can create an account and log in. This is actually a free text description of the test case. So this is something that you can totally freely choose. Obviously, it should be something that somehow makes sense and somehow explains what you want to achieve. And then at the next point, you see the blue rectangles on the left side and the green ones on the right side. So on the left side, we have so-called keywords. And on the right side, we have variables that are actually being passed to these keywords. So what happens in here, if you take a look at the first step, you see there's a keyword called create valid user. And it's having two variables called thread and password. And we don't really know what has been tested with there, but we somehow can imagine what probably the sense is. And somebody writes a test case maybe for testing a web shop application, creates a user with a creating a user account. Then at the next step, he tries to log in, as we can see in here, attempt to log in with credentials using the very same credentials. And at the end, the status should be logged in. So what you see on the left side are the keywords. The keywords are then converted by the library to actually Python or Java code, depending on what you choose to use. And then this framework is actually waiting for this library to pass back the result. And in this case, if all the three steps were successful, the total use case or the total test case is successful as well. As you can see in the next step, it's more or less the same, but in this case, a new user screen created and the wrong password is, and you can see at the end, the access, the status should be access denied. So this is what I meant with abstraction. Yeah? So you don't really, in order to write the test case, don't have to know what is being happening on the Python backend, but you can still define and change your own test cases based on this. So what we then actually did is we checked for the different vendors that we usually tend to work with. Some of them even supply libraries for the robot framework. However, the problem with these is they're always written in a certain way that is usually quite incompatible with the way that another vendor has written these kind of keywords. And obviously, they only work for their own equipment. So what we had in our mind was it would be really cool if you would create a library that would allow a network engineer to write his own test cases, and the library would then check, okay, is it a Juniper device, is it an iOS XR device, is it Huawei device, or is it whatever, and then call the responsible function to actually execute the test case. So what you see in here is an example from the library that we have written. And in this case, for the first test case, the name is check core BFD. So I guess everybody in the room who knows what BFD is already gets an idea what we are actually going to test there. Then the test case itself, I will just read it out because the coloring is not that cleverly chosen by me. In this case, it's written in there, verify BFD session on Gelsenkirchen for interface Ethernet 003 with peer 10.0.0.0 is in state up. So it's a bit different than you saw in the example before because we have actually embedded the variables into the keywords. So the first variable is the host name Gelsenkirchen, which translates to a DNS name or an IP address, and at the end, a device under test, like a Juniper MX router or whatever you prefer in there. Then the next one is behind interface. This is actually the interface variable passed to the library, and then we say, on this device, for this interface, the BFD session to this peer should be in the state up. And the robot framework will actually call this library, execute this check on the device, and report whether this is the case or whether this is not the case. And as you can see here, we have two test steps, so two different checks and two different interfaces. As both of them will pass, the framework will also report that the test case had passed and move on to the next one. So this is just an example, but I think it already shows into which direction this is going, because if you give this to as an example to a networking engineer who is responsible for doing network qualification testing, he directly knows what is being tested in here, and he will directly be able to actually adapt this and adhere this or change it to his needs and based what he would like to test in there. Now, these kind of test documents, as I mentioned, usually these end up in some overly complex Word documents with a few hundred pages. Obviously, this is not really scalable if you just have one flat test file where you just put in all of your test cases and see what happens. Another cool thing about the framework is that you can actually structure your test cases using directories. So as you can see in here, there's a directory called demo at the top. There are certain subdirectories like BFD, BGP, there's a subdirectory called L3VPN for IPv4, IPv6. And actually, in each of these directories, there are certain test files being defined. So the nice thing is you can actually point the framework to a single file, then it will execute all the checks that are being defined in this file. Or you can point it to a directory, and in this case, it will actually execute all the checks in this directory and in all subdirectories in there. So you can decide if you want to run the complete test suite or just parts of it. And this structure will also be, you will also be able to see the structure at the report that you get at the end of this activity. Because this is usually what comes out of the framework if you don't do anything special. So this is one of the built-in functions. It reports the test results once the test has been run. So you can see in here down on the bottom, we have still again these kind of structure. We have the demo folder, the demo.bfd, demo.bgp, and all the tests that are part of this. And it actually reported us that this test case, it was actually 807 test steps, as we see at the top for the total test cases. And the test run was for 2 minutes and 6 seconds. So basically around 6 test cases or 6 test steps per second. Now this number comes in this case from a test that just tested stuff on a device under test itself. In this case by doing RPC calls and checking what the result is. So this is really, really fast. If you include some external testing authorities like traffic generators, usually it gets a bit slower because these kind of devices have to program the changes on the FPGAs before they actually can do stuff. But if you just do testing on the device itself, it's really fast. So this is actually an example from a very early implementation that we used in a proof of concept earlier this year. And in this case, we used it as a network health check. So what we basically do, or what you usually basically do if you run proof of concept, you want to test convergence time, what happens if I plug out a cable, if I plug it back in, what happens if I plug out a line card, and so on and so on. And usually you forget to plug something back in there. So we just needed a tool to actually be sure that the network is in a good and healthy state. And that's what we used it for in this stage. However, at the next stage, we actually want to run the complete test case automatically without any manual interference. So if something breaks down, you can see in here, they can actually dig in into the test case that has failed. So, and this example is probably a bit small, but you can get it in the slides afterwards. So what we see in here, we have two test cases where we are checking BGP status about a certain layer 3 VPN, and the third instance has actually failed. And what is written down there at the bottom, it's actually writing why the test case has failed. In this case, the test case has failed because the actual state of the session was active, but we expected it to be established. So it has failed, and you have to check why this is actually the case. Now, the problem with doing this kind of proof of concept test or also software qualification test is you never have the possibility to actually mimic the network completely as you have it in your live network. Usually, customers don't want to have exactly a copy of their production network in their lab. Usually, it's just a boiled down versions. But there are actually tools to get closer to the real network design with a limited number of devices. So for us, we have been working with Ixia for quite some time. So people in the room who have also worked with Ixia and know IX Network probably know this screenshot down there. For those who don't know it, basically it's a, you could say it's a traffic generator, but it's much, much more. Because if it's just about generating packets at a certain data rate, you can use a lot of open source tools for this. They are freely available and they work quite well. However, if you want to testing control plane and data plane events at scale at the same time, it's probably usually getting difficult by just using open source tools. So in this case, the Ixia is simulating two P-routers on the right side of the network that is talking ISIS, BFD, and LDP to the device under test. And afterwards, we are simulating something like 50 PE routers that talk BGP to the device under test. And at some point in time, we are sending traffic from the customer prefixes with the correct labels over to the device under test and check the behavior under scale. And the nice thing is, also, Ixia is really deep into automation. So Ixia started to do automation when TCL was very a popular scripting language, but it's not that more. However, they have a lot of additional possibilities. There are libraries for Python, there are libraries for Perl. They started to include a REST API in their recent releases, which is actually what we used at the beginning to automate the testing. So we called the REST API of the Ixia to do stuff like this, to start traffic, check for packet loss, and so on. Later on, this has been recently, Ixia also released a new Python library, which is based on the REST API. So if you like to program in Python and work with IX Network, you should really look at this. It's actually being installable via pip. The name is IX Network-RestPy. It's really cool. You should take a look at this. And by integrating this, the Ixia and the testing framework, we have the possibilities to more or less completely automatically run the test framework and also the test that our customer needs. And this is also where we are going to head to. So what our goal is to get in touch with the customers that we have, define a predefined test case or test suite with a lot of test cases inside there, and then enable us to do the complete automated software qualification testing for our customers either in our lab or also on customer premises. So we are also talking with two customers in Germany now that are really interested into this topic, but they would like to prefer to do this on site. They also have their own traffic generators. Even if they wouldn't have, then we could also bring our test generator to the site and help them to speed up this software qualification testing from months to just days or weeks, probably just days. So what does it mean for you? So actually, you have two possibilities that you can go through. You can either go the same way as we did, so take all the components that we used, like the robot framework, the testing capabilities that you have, define your libraries, define your test cases, and automate your software qualification testing with these tools. Or, of course, you can get in touch with us, and we can help you to speed this process up. So I have a short, well, I cannot really say it's a demonstration because it's actually a recorded video of a demonstration, but it was easier for working with a standard laptop here to put this as a video inside there. However, if you have interest to see it in real life, as a real life demo, I'm more than happy to do this. Just get in touch with us. So this is a very easy or simple example of about a test case where we are testing HCOS functionality. So we see we have a device under test. In this case, it's a Juniper MX, but well, it doesn't really matter. We have the Ixia test system on the left, the Ixia test system on the right. We are sending traffic from left to right. On the right side, we actually have two VLANs defined that correspond to two services. The first service, VLAN 100, has a maximum guaranteed rate of 100 megabits. With voice traffic inside this 100 megabit being guaranteed 10 megabits. And we have the customer 200 who is being bought a 200 megabits service, and the voice class is actually being guaranteed 20 megabits of this service. And then usually what we do in this kind of test, when we do qualification test, you test, okay, what happens if customer 100 exceeds this rate? What happens to his voice traffic? Is this still being serviced as long as it's under this 10%? What happens if the voice is also increasing above this limit? Is it policed to this limit? Is the best effort traffic maybe of another customer, of the customer 200, somehow affected by this? Then you repeat this test over and over again with customer 200. In this case, with different rates, but you still do the same kind of test. You want to test what is the maximum rate that is being received on a tester side. Has the policing level or the way that the policer is being calculated by the vendor, has this maybe been changed on the new version of code? Or maybe because it's a new piece of hardware, or a forwarding chipset that has been changed, and this one is calculating it differently? And this is something that really takes ages if you do this manually, and this is also a point where you make mistakes if you do this for 8 hours a day. So I've done a few of these software qualification tests in my life, and I usually make mistakes. If I do this for 8 hours during the day, usually at the end up where you summarize all the results, you see, oh, I forgot to capture the results from the test case number 16 just before lunch, and I've completely skipped one of the test cases. This is just normal that at some point in time you may make to start making errors. However, if you have this completely automated, you have a reproducible fashion, and you can be sure to always get the same kind of result if the devices are always behaving in the same way. So what I have in here is a video. What you see on the right side in a minute is actually the graphical user interface from the Ixia. Let me just see if I can quickly start and stop this. So on the right side, you actually see the traffic items. So these are these items in here. So for the people in the front row, you can try to actually check this column in here, because this is the frame rate for the different traffic items. And this will change over the time when the robot framework is going to the different test. For the people in the back side, we have these nice gorges in here. So these are usually completely useless if you run this kind of test, because they just tell you, hey, you are losing some packets somewhere. But for the larger audience, it's nice because you can actually see something from the backside. So on the left side, there's actually a CLI from the system where the robot framework is actually being executed on. So we implemented it in a way that we spin up a Docker container that is executing the test case, saving the results, and once the Docker container is finished, it will just dump the results and then stop to appear and get away. So I will just start this over now, and basically what happens in here in the first step is that the container is actually being spun up and started. We see in here that there are currently no files on this server. This is where we actually store the results once the test run has been completed. And now the next step is that the framework is actually being kicked off and started. And so at the first step, it makes some kind of basic checks whether the XCI is being programmed correctly, whether all IP addresses are somehow reachable. And then it starts to actually kick off the traffic and to update the traffic rates of the different traffic items. So in the first step, we are doing this for customer 100. We are sending, I believe, something around 70 megabits per second, so it's below the threshold that he is allowed, so we are not expecting any drops there. Then as the next step, as you can see already here, we're increasing it a bit, but still in contract. As the next test case, which is just happening right now, we are exceeding this allowed limit. And of course, what we want to see in here is that the voice traffic is not being affected by this, only the best effect traffic is being dropped by the test routine. So this is what is actually happening in here now. And basically, what's happening is we are testing some stuff on the device itself, because some stuff you can only test on the device itself, like, for example, if it has been put the traffic into the right queue. But some point or some stuff is tested on the XCI itself, because checking the real traffic rate that is being received on the customer end, you cannot test this on a device under test, because by definition, you don't trust this device during a software qualification test, so you have to have an external authority to actually verify this. Now, while I'm speaking, the test is already continuing with the customer 200. So you see it's not these six test cases per second, because the XCI is involved and every change on the XCI takes a few seconds until it's actually being processed by the hardware. But it's still a lot faster than if you would do it manually and record all the test steps, because this happens in the background. Every test case saves the result. So it will tell you afterwards, not only, hey, this test completed, but it can also just log the result. Like, for example, I was able to transmit that amount of traffic for voice and that amount of traffic for best effort traffic until I reached the limit at some point in time. So this is actually the last test case. The voice traffic is also exceeding its limit now, and obviously we want to see that it's being polarized to the correct amount of traffic. Now the container closes itself. The results are actually stored in the HTML files. And this is something that we can now see, and it's basically what we have seen before in the slides. So we can go, if this is now being refreshed, you see that we have the report. We see that one of these test cases down there actually failed, and you can, that's the nice thing about the HTML stuff, you can just click in there and then it will tell you what the actual problem was. So in this case, the problem was that I specified that the packet that the device under test should allow around 2,000 packets per second during this test case, but the XCI only received 1,600 something, so the test case failed. And so you know that something is not really working in this specific amount of test. Now, these HTML documents are quite nice, because they are quite interactive, but here we also have the possibility, which is something that we have written, to actually also generate a PDF report out of this, and it basically contains the same results as before. So to sum this up, what really is the cool thing about this, you can think about a totally different way to actually do your software qualification. Because before, what you usually do is you have to find some kind of trade-off between the amount of time that you put in and the result you get out. And obviously, you would like to test everything, but it takes too much time. If you automate this, it doesn't matter at all. You leave the test running during the night, it doesn't matter if it runs for 6 hours or 10 hours, it's still much faster. So you can just test everything that you need on this device. So, I hope I was not too long. I think it's somehow matching with the timing. So, not sure if we still have time for questions.
Very briefly, has anyone got any questions? Well, if you have, maybe you can catch Stefan later.
Sure.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we're going to hand over to Simon.